Planes! Forget about trains and automobiles for a moment, because our purview today is to slide up that weird little porthole window, annoy the people in the seat behind us, and peek out at the vast expanse of cloud and the wonderment of the atmosphere, whilst trying to stare down at how impossibly tiny everything looks from 35,000 feet in the air. The thing is, the Mile High Club is an incredibly unique perspective, where we can look down at our awesome planet and stare in awe at the diversity of our homeworld. Jungles, deserts, oceans, and high-rise metropoles. But have you ever wondered where all the polar biomes are? Have you ever wondered why planes don't fly over Antarctica? Let's find out. Hello internet, what's going on? And once again, welcome back to the most inquisitive channel on YouTube, Life's Biggest Questions. As per usual, I'll be your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finches. Today, we curiously ask the question, why don't planes fly over Antarctica? The curious amongst you, that clip was from 1983's Antarctica, also known as South Pole Story, an incredibly moving film by Kuroyoshi Kurahara about the survival of a group of loyal and loving Sakhalin Huskies of an ill-fated 1958 Japanese expedition to the South Pole. And yeah, whilst we're on the topic of the Antarctic, we may as well highlight one of the most moving and emotional tales in expeditionary history. Seriously, that movie will make you cry. But hey, let's pull ourselves together for a moment and get back to the ever-pending mystery before us. So why exactly does the South Pole get no love when it comes to airtime? What about the North Pole? Is that treated the same way? Well, no, not at all. In fact, ever since the dissolution of the Soviet Union and the tentative relaxation of aviation agreements between Russia and its Arctic neighbors, the North Pole has been the Silk Road for airlines ferrying passengers across the top of the world to Asia, the Middle East, and then back again. But come on, that's not exactly fair, is it? What about the South Pole? What about Antarctica? If you're looking for the long and short answer to this question, on the surface, it is relatively straightforward. Money. One of the major reasons as to why our Southern Pole isn't the hive of air traffic that it could and should be is because it just isn't economically viable enough to build an entire aviation economy around it. As the old saying goes, time is money, and a plane flying over the Antarctic just for the sake of an otherwise different landscape simply doesn't cut the mustard. However, whilst that is the short answer, there is a little bit more to it rather than just the number crunching of commercial aviation. You see, the reason why it doesn't make economical sense is because, for lack of a better term, Antarctica is just too far out of the way, and rather than just economics playing their part here, it's much simpler. It's geography. Due to the geographical arrangement of the three most populated southern continents, flying over Antarctica simply isn't the most efficient route for any airline to take. And well, when you're flying a steel bird at over 30,000 feet in the air with finite fuel to propel you along your journey, it goes without saying that the most direct route is probably always the safest bet. Right at the bottom of the world, the southern hemispherical continents of South America, Africa, and Australia form a rough triangle, and the simplest passage along that triangle is that the shortest leg between the three or four of their largest airports simply, well, it misses Antarctica. It flies right over it, given the fact that, yeah, the Pacific Ocean is kind of freaking huge. The thing is though, those routes are entirely hypothetical at this point, also given the fact that, once again, the economics of aviation dictate just how sustainable a flight path needs to be before it's worthwhile running a regular commercial airliner. That would be Sydney to Johannesburg, Buenos Aires, and or Santiago. You see, while there certainly are some direct flights that use those routes, they're hella expensive, and none of them, you see, travel over Antarctica. Hey, now those annoying connecting flights are starting to make a little more sense, right? But there is one more deciding factor in this stick in the mud of aviation, and surprisingly, other than the very clear-cut mechanics of, you know, geography, guess who's to blame? Yeah, of course, you guessed it. It's the United States of America. Wait, what? Well, yeah, although the short answer to this question certainly is money, the long answer to this question is the USA. And before you get all uppity, don't worry, wind your neck in, because it's a good thing. Let's cast our gaze back through the raging sands of time to the year 1964. A time where the United States Federal Aviation Agency called the shots, and still do to this day. Up until that point in time, there was a very strict aviation rule that stated twin engine planes could not fly for more than 60 minutes away from a diversion airport in the case of an emergency engine failure. That makes sense, right? Given the era, the rule came about down to the most common engine of the time, the piston engine, which was notoriously unreliable. That's the reason why, for the early days of transoceanic aviation, most planes were literally flying boats. It was way safer to make sure your plane had the ability to turn into a boat if, you know, one of their engines just gave up halfway across the Atlantic. And also, you'd only ever be 60 minutes away from the nearest airport, given the law. And that's great. But then, at the time of 1964, enter the jet engine, and enter the golden age of civilian airliners. Gone are the days of planes being boats. Now it's the era of jet setting, and enter an aviation law known as ETOPS, Extended Range Twin Engine Performance. This law, gradually over the mid-80s up until now, has allowed airliners to increase their range over time. First, 120 minutes away from the nearest airport, then 180, and now the furthest ETOPS rating is a staggering 330 minutes. Now, you can, in aviation law, fly with a single engine for 6 hours. Whew. Thank you, ETOPS. Yay. That means you could fly a single engine plane from the southernmost tip of South America to Antarctica and then back again. What for? I don't know, just because we can, to see the penguins. Research, I guess. Why else? But wait, hold on a minute. How does a single engine with a flight limit of 6 hours have anything to do with Antarctica? Well, you see, it doesn't. Unless you are, as we said, a research scientist and or penguin enthusiast. In fact, given the parameters of this question, just for the sake of flying over Antarctica on any one of the previously mentioned southern hemispherical flight paths, you'd need a commercial airliner with 4 engines just to make the trip possible and worthwhile. And then guess what? We're back to the short answer again. They cost a hell of a lot of money, and not many people want to fly that route. You see, some flights do come quite close. Auckland to Buenos Aires is of a similar distance, but still, it doesn't make any sense to fly over Antarctica. It's the same with Sydney to Johannesburg or Sydney to Santiago. Close, but no cigar. You see, whilst there is a lot more to this question in terms of logistics and, more importantly, logic, sometimes, unless there's money involved, things just don't happen the way that they could. So, sorry Antarctica, until you're a sprawling polar metropolis, no commercial airlines for you. Well, there we have it, folks, our long and short answer to the question, why don't planes fly over Antarctica? What do you guys think? Do you agree, disagree, have any more to add? Then let us know your thoughts down in the comment section below, as well as any intriguing insights you may have on the matter. Before we depart from today's video, let's first take a quick look at some of your more creative comments from over the past few days. Lone Wolf says, what if Jack Finch was really just a finch that speaks into a microphone? Cheap? Well, unfortunately, it looks like my feathers have been well and truly ruffled. So on that note, that's what we've got time for in today's video. Cheers for sticking around all the way until the end. If you were a fan of this video or just Life's Biggest Questions in general, then please be a dear and hit that thumbs up button, as well as that subscribe bell. And I'll be seeing you in the next one. As per usual, I've been your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch. You've been watching Life's Biggest Questions. And until next time, you take it easy.